Can be ready to start this experiment. I'm going to give you this cup that contains lysergic acid 100 microgram. Will you drink it?
What I'm hungry for is not this sort of thing, because I want to feed off of this feeling of joy, which seems to be coming from everything. But somehow I don't seem like I myself. I feel as though I'm several other people, and all of them better.
A little while ago, a buddy of mine on Twitter posted several screenshots of newspaper articles from the 50s discussing what had generally been accepted as the role of serotonin. One article was titled, "Normal Thinking, Hormones Studied." They described how serotonin could sedate animals and how serotonin is involved in the biochemistry of normal mental processes. One article stated, "The cancer cells get serotonin, which they apparently need to fuel their wild, uncontrollable growth." It goes on to state, other researchers had found that serotonin is blocked by the drug lysergic acid diethylamide, LSD, which is much used by psychiatrists to induce madness and hallucinations in human experimental work on mental disease. Dr. Scott tried LSD on rats with rapidly growing transplanted cancers. It slowed the malignant growth by as much as 80 to 90% and in some cases stopped it entirely. Wait, hold up. So not only is serotonin causative of cancer growth, but it was also being touted as the normal thinking hormone when it opposes the effects of LSD. LSD makes you more creative, spontaneous, and notoriously anti-establishment.
It makes you more aware, more considerate. Yes, thinking about more possibilities. I mean, that's what people call paranoia.
A typical drill sergeant ordered his men to fall in. The squad, composed of volunteers for the test, responded like well-trained soldiers, immediately and without question. 2 hours later, the squad, all except the drill sergeant, now drugged with LSD, again was ordered to fall in. The response was not the same. The squad leader thought it was not necessary for him to dress right. After a few minutes, the men found it difficult to obey orders. And soon, the results were chaotic.
To get a better understanding of serotonin, it helps to learn about the powerful serotonin antagonist, LSD. In 1938, Swiss chemist Albert Hofmann was working for Sandoz Pharmaceutical to create a respiratory and circulatory stimulant, and on November 16th, he unknowingly created LSD. However, it wasn't until 5 years later, in 1943, that he accidentally absorbed his creation. It made him feel restless and dizzy. He described the feelings as being a not unpleasant, intoxicated-like condition. For the next 2 hours, he was between an incredible imagination and a dreamlike state with an uninterrupted stream of amazing pictures, shapes, and colors. 3 days later, he purposefully dosed himself with 250 micrograms of the acid. An hour later, he began to freak out and he wanted to go home. Because of wartime restrictions, he was forced to take his bike home. On this stressful bike ride, he felt as though he was motionless until the drug's effects reached a climax. He then said, "Now, little by little, I could begin to enjoy the unprecedented colors and plays of shapes that persisted behind my closed eyes. Kaleidoscopic, fantastic images surged in on me, alternating, variegated, opening and then closing in on themselves in circles and spirals, exploding in colored fountains, rearranging and hybridizing themselves in constant flux."
Sandoz, the company Hofmann worked for, provided LSD-25 for free to scientists around the world.
They basically unleashed this open source research effort where they offered huge amounts of it to any researcher, basically with a nice piece of stationery.
I could feel with my eyes.
It was LSD that catalyzed our understanding of neurotransmitters and receptors, and also the development of other psychiatric drugs.
Clinical researchers investigated LSD as a treatment for a wide range of mental illnesses.
They looked at obsession, anxiety, depression. They looked especially at alcoholism and had a 50% success rate, which is quite remarkable.
Psychedelics became a standard tool in psychotherapy.
It would help people speed the process of bringing their subconscious to where you could discuss it with your therapist. There was a lot of this going on in the 50s.
While well-intentioned research was being conducted in the following decades, groups with more nefarious intentions began to show an interest in LSD. After the Second World War, the United States government was intent on beating their adversaries in the Soviet Union and resorted to many questionable and outright unethical psychological experiments. Upon receiving intelligence that during the Korean War, captured American soldiers were being subjected to mind control experiments and then killed, U.S. interest was sparked to one-up the communists' mind control abilities. Their stated goal was to make a person completely subservient to a perceived control and commit acts that they otherwise wouldn't have committed and then have no recollection of it. This individual would be known as a Manchurian candidate. The CIA wanted to see if they could create Manchurian candidates or see how US spies would hold up if mind control techniques were used against them. Dr. Sidney Gottlieb, an American chemist and spy master, created Operation Bluebird, later known as MKUltra. Although the Nuremberg Code prevented experimentation on human subjects without their consent, MKUltra conducted many experiments in secrecy on how biological and chemical materials can alter human behavior. Thousands of people participated in some 162 separate projects, having no idea what they were getting into. Gottlieb's idea of mind control involved two steps. First, you had to blast away the existing mind. Second, you had to find a way to insert a new mind into that existing void. He believed the best way to blast away the existing mind was LSD. In the early 1950s, the CIA bought the world's entire known supply of LSD. Although Gottlieb technically had supervisors, they didn't want to know the details of what was going on, so he pretty much had free rein to do whatever he wanted without reporting it. The CIA was up to all kinds of shenanigans. They were experimenting on psychiatric patients, soldiers, and prostitutes, and even secretly dosing each other with acid. One specific project was called Project Midnight Climax. Unsuspected men throughout the United States were lured into prostitution and supposedly dosed with LSD. There would be a two-way mirror in which the exchange would go on. This means in the room, there was what seemed to be a mirror, but on the other side, there were CIA agents watching and filming what was going on. This went on for an estimated 10 years. It seems rather odd, especially that LSD is not really an aphrodisiac, that CIA agents were watching guys pay for sex. What seems more likely is that this is a cover-up. Maybe the male participants were high-profile people that the CIA could blackmail with these incriminating tapes. Was acid really involved, or was it just a smokescreen? With that background, we can talk about the story of Frank Olson. He was a bacteriologist who worked on developing top-secret bioweapons for the US Army and then later became a CIA employee. In another part of the world, while the Korean War was coming to an end, reports came out that the US had been involved in using germ warfare in North Korea. According to reports, Olson also witnessed CIA interrogations in which they committed murder with biological weapons that he created. He became very conflicted with his work and whether or not what he was doing was moral. He knew that his life would be in danger if he blew the whistle, so he requested to be let go from the program. After being evaluated and profiled by a staff psychiatrist, the agency was growing concerned that he would spill the secrets of his involvement in the creation of bioweapons. On November 28, 1953, Olson plummeted to his death from the 10th story of the Statler Hotel in New York City. The police report stated that he threw himself out the window. In 1975, the Rockefeller Commission uncovered some of the CIA's MKUltra activities and the government came out and said that Olson was dosed with LSD 9 days before and it may have led him to kill himself. The government paid out the family $750,000 in settlement, but his son, Eric Olson, was not convinced of the official story. Eric later had the body exhumed and another autopsy conducted. Upon investigation of the body, Frank Olson had a blunt trauma injury on his head and a large injury on his chest. Most of the autopsy team concluded that these traumas were not the result of a fall, leading to a compelling theory that Olson was instead murdered because he was at risk of disclosing classified information. It seems as though the use of LSD was yet another smokescreen from the heinous behavior of the feds. In 1963, the CIA Inspector General learned of the program and he called it distasteful and unethical, and MKUltra was scaled down. After a while, Gottlieb believed that mind control was not possible with LSD, and in 1973, the CIA director ordered all documentation of the project to be destroyed. The existing information comes from the 8,000 financial documents and many witness testimonies that were not destroyed. With all of the evidence destroyed, could MKUltra just be the tip of the iceberg? On another note, journalist John Greenwald obtained freedom of information requests that the CIA was able to implant devices into the brains of dogs to remotely control their behaviors. Was LSD just a cover-up for more abominable experiments? As we will see, LSD seems to have the opposite effect of mind control. While LSD was wrongfully getting vilified by shady government operations, more research was being done on the hormone that LSD opposes, serotonin. A drug called reserpine was found to deplete a class of neurotransmitters called the monoamines and cause lethargy, which in animals looks similar to depression we see in humans. This was the birth of the hypothesis that a deficiency in certain brain chemicals could cause depression. Keyword there being hypothesis. Apparently, it was ignored that the only long-term clinical trial using reserpine actually showed that it had an antidepressant effect. Researchers and historians alike have since realized that the reserpine-induced depression model is essentially a myth. Nonetheless, this born the era of drugs aimed to up the concentrations of these neurotransmitters. First were the monoamine oxidase inhibitors, then, once the value of serotonin was realized, the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or SSRIs. That value was in the form of a handful of studies showing that some people who committed suicide had lower levels of serotonin. I guess it was also ignored that several studies have either shown no difference or actually more serotonin in depressed patients. There was no time to consider that, since pharmaceutical conglomerate Lilly had cherry-picked their studies and went to work on the first SSRIs.
It's the hottest psychiatric drug in history.
Prozac.
A wonder drug that works wonders.
A 2000 Boston Globe review of some of Lilly's internal documents states, 3 years before Prozac received approval by the U.S. Food and Drug Administration in late 1987, the German BGA, that country's FDA equivalent, had such serious reservations about Prozac's safety that it refused to approve the antidepressant based on Lilly's studies showing that previously non-suicidal patients who took the drug had a five-fold higher rate of suicides and suicide attempts than those on older antidepressants, and a three-fold higher rate than those taking placebos. Internal documents show that in 1990, Lilly scientists were pressured by corporate executives to alter records on physician experiences with Prozac, changing mentions of suicide attempt to overdose and suicidal thoughts to depression.
But even with the latest medical technology and the best circumstances, we don't know what chemical pellet is right. We're basically throwing what we think are darts in a pitch black room at a target that only maybe exists. But I'm hoping that if I show you a bottle of these brain chemicals near pleasant things, you'll learn to associate my chemicals with pleasant feelings.
One 2006 law review cites multiple incidents of conglomerates like Lilly and GSK going out of their way to suppress research showing their SSRIs cause more suicides and violent tendencies. The review states, Harvard psychiatrist Martin H. Tyker's 1990 report on Prozac was one of the first reports addressing how SSRIs could cause suicidal or homicidal tendencies. Tyker studied six depressed patients who prior to their first dosage of Prozac did not exhibit suicidal or violent behavior. Tyker was amazed at the results of the study. All of his patients developed violent tendencies after 26 days of taking Prozac. Tyker explained that two patients tried to conceal their suicidal feelings and impulses and continue Prozac treatment, believing that the drug would eventually enable them to successfully kill themselves.
Well, with today's pharmacology, no one needs to suffer with feelings of exhaustion and depression.
Here we go. Here comes the Prozac.
These companies were fully aware of the implications the hidden data would have on the public, but kept them on the market and continued to push their agenda. The original goal of these legal accusations was to pull these drugs completely off the market, but they had to settle for an FDA black box warning of these potential side effects. Interestingly, a book on ways to make army performance better on the battlefield details why they should be lowering their serotonin. They speak of how dopamine, providing elevated mood, motivation, and energy, would be critical for doing well in war, and that increases in serotonin and adenosine play roles in decreasing dopamine levels. They go on to talk about how higher blood sugar attenuates the increase in brain serotonin that is typically associated with tiredness, lethargy, depression, and low arousal. heritable factors such as allelic variants of the gene for the serotonin transporter, which inactivates serotonin at the synapse, can render individuals more vulnerable to stress early in life and at greater risk for depression in adulthood. So the government and its associated bodies clearly have a much different view on serotonin than the happy chemical moniker we've all been fed would suggest. Animal experiments seem to corroborate this. This study examining horses found that the higher the serotonin, the more trainable and less dominant the horses would be. Now, correlation doesn't imply causation, but you know what does? Causation. One experiment simply titled Serotonin Reverses Dominant Social Status is pretty much exactly what you would expect. Monkeys, when given drugs that increase serotonin availability, experienced increased aggressiveness and decreased social dominance. Sounds pretty much like the perfect combination to control the population, if you ask me. With all of this considered, it has to be questioned if the glorification of serotonin and the demonization of LSD were done maliciously to make population control easier. It's important to understand what serotonin's role in nature is to understand why the reputation it has now is totally misguided. Serotonin is a part of the symphony of stress hormones along with cortisol, adrenaline, and noradrenaline, just to name a few. In fact, noradrenaline and adrenaline, the fight or flight hormones, are both increased in animals who cannot synthesize serotonin, suggesting they are substituting in for the absence of serotonin. These animals were also significantly leaner than normal mice. Consistent with the stress response, serotonin also suppresses appetite, yet it seems to promote fat gain, one of the potential reasons for why those who take SSRIs may put on some weight. Going along with this, it is interesting to see that cortisol, the hormone typically associated with chronic stress, increases brain serotonin levels. This effect seems to go both ways too, as there are case reports of serotonin receptor antagonists putting Cushing's disease into remission. Cushing's disease is the release of massive quantities of cortisol due to an adrenal tumor. Interestingly, the levels of cortisol in Cushing's disease are correlated directly with the incidence and severity of depression. It has also been estimated that around 90% of all cases of depression are initiated by a stressful event. As mentioned in the last video, animals are known to have an upregulation of serotonin in order to initiate hibernation. With everything we know about the actions of serotonin on the body, it makes perfect sense. Serotonin slows down the metabolism, promotes the storage of energy, suppresses appetite, and causes lethargy. These properties would make serotonin useful to ensure you make it through the winter. Fasting is a trigger to release more serotonin, since it is the signal of scarcity. One of serotonin's physiological functions is to be a vasoconstrictor in response to inflammation. Platelet serotonin transporters are responsible for pulling serotonin out of the blood and using it to produce coagulants, which impedes blood flow by thickening the blood. It should then come as no surprise that serotonin is directly related to hypertension, and that drugs that block serotonin have been found to improve blood pressure. Again, serotonin's energy-conserving properties would be advantageous if you were sick, since you'd want to devote it to the immune response. It needs to be understood that this is the role of serotonin. It is an evolutionary signal that you are in a state of stress and energy must be conserved for only vital processes. That stress could be sickness, a lack of food, or something else. But the signal is that using extra energy for other activities must be slowed to ensure survival. Things like socializing, problem solving, exercising, and the like are discouraged since they are considered non-essential. Reproducing is also looked at as something that you wouldn't want to do at the moment. One study claims, dopamine is generally facilitative to male sexual behavior. However, serotonin is regarded as inhibitory. Antidepressants of the selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor class, SSRIs, including Prozac and Zoloft, impair ejaculatory and orgasmic function and frequently inhibit erectile function and sexual interest as well. Microinjection of large doses of serotonin into the genitals impaired male sexual behavior in rats. Think about the last time you were tired. You were probably cranky, maybe you'd snap at someone prematurely, and you'd probably be much less willing to consider new ideas that threaten your current worldview. You'd also more than likely weren't in the mood to get in the sack. This is the state of low energy, a state in which serotonin is meant to promote. Injecting serotonin into mice has been shown to decrease brain energy production by causing a shift towards anaerobic glycolysis, a far less efficient way of producing energy from glucose. This is of particular interest because not only does the brain use proportionally, by far, the most energy of any organ and is pretty important to being able to live at all, but brain energy production plays an absolutely critical role in your day-to-day quality of life. there is a direct correlation between depressive symptom severity and inefficient energy production, and agents that can restore proper energy production also act as antidepressants. Our minds, our happiness, our ability to think clearly and about complex subjects depend on good energy production from the brain. Our sophisticated metabolism is what makes us sophisticated, makes us human. It should then come as no surprise that things that damper this property facilitate more inhumane type behavior.
The 1999 attack at Columbine High School opened a new chapter in America's modern history of mass murder. 13 people shot to death, 24 wounded by 2 high school boys. The media linked the shooting to violent video games. Buried beneath the Washington Post headlines, Eric Harris's treatment with the antidepressant Luvox. 14 years later, claims of a link between antidepressants and violence have grown louder, if not really clearer. Last July 20th, police say James Holmes walked into a midnight showing of the latest Batman movie in Aurora, Colorado, and opened fire, killing 12, wounding 58. The Denver Post reported Holmes was taking generic Zoloft, an SSRI. According to the New York Times, after Jared Loftner pleaded guilty to killing 6 and wounding 9 in the 2011 attack in Tucson that severely injured Congresswoman Gabby Giffords, he told his doctor he wished he had taken the antidepressants he'd been prescribed long before the shootings.
In May 1998, 15-year-old Kip Kinkle murdered his parents and 2 classmates, as well as injuring 25 others, after engaging in a shooting spree that ended up in his school's cafeteria. In the investigation, it emerged that he had been taking popular antidepressant medication Prozac since the summer of the previous year. In December 2000, Michael McDermott went on a shooting rampage at his workplace, Edgewater Technologies, killing 7 of his coworkers. During his trial, the court heard testimony that in the weeks before the shooting, McDermott had tripled the dosage of his antidepressant medication, Prozac, from 70 milligrams per day to 210 milligrams. In March 2005, 16-year-old Jeff Weiss shot and killed 9 people, including 5 students at Red Lake Senior High School in Minnesota, before turning the gun on himself. It was later revealed he had been undergoing treatment for depression and had been on Prozac at the time. In September 2008, Finnish post-secondary student Matti Saari shot and killed 10 other students on campus before killing himself. The official Finnish government report on the incident revealed that he had been taking an SSRI medication at the time of the shooting.
Last time, we talked about how lactic acid, something that impairs the ability to efficiently burn energy, caused intense rage in people who committed domestic violence. Serotonin, known to generate lactic acid in the brain, also has been seen to have similar properties. For example, animals administered with anti-serotonergic drugs have seen reductions in perceived anger, with the authors claiming, in support of this conclusion was the observed potentiation of anti-aggressive effects by blocking serotonin receptors. One study even found a link between serotonin and violent crimes. As the temperature outside increases, fewer serotonin transporters are created, meaning more is left available in the blood. The concentrations of these platelet serotonin transporters were inversely correlated with more violent crimes. Of course, when the media found out about this, the narrative became about how global warming is a contributor to crime, instead of pointing out how serotonin may play a major role. The media has done an extraordinary job at making sure that serotonin's name does not get stained, no matter the consequences.
About a year ago, I posted a study on the forum, probably even 2 years ago, which showed that dementia, the Alzheimer's dementia, is actually driven by serotonin excess. And the way this was reported in the popular press was really diabolical, really nefarious. They actually said that serotonin deficiency is what causes Alzheimer's disease. But if you look at the actual study, it wasn't serotonin deficiency. It was a deficiency of the serotonin transporter protein known as SERT, S-E-R-T. Mm-hmm. That is the protein that deactivates serotonin. So if you have a deficiency of SERT, you're going to have an excess of extracellular serotonin. The SERT protein is the exact protein that the SSRI drugs target. They inhibit. An actual excess of extracellular serotonin was found to be a possible cause of dementia/Alzheimer's. And now this study comes along, and it was reported the exact same way in the popular press. I looked at the study and it was the exact same thing. It was by different authors. And actually I emailed the authors because I got really, really infuriated. I'm like, why would you? Because even the authors in the popular press article, because they got interviewed, they said it was a dysfunction of the serotonin system. And I got like, well, what a cheap way to, why don't you just say it's not a, yes, technically it's true, it's a dysfunction of the serotonin system. But if it was something related to dopamine or thyroid or testosterone, you have no problem saying a deficiency of something, right? Or an excess of something. I sent a mass email to all of the authors of the study, and then only one of them responded. She's like, we were pretty explicit that this means serotonin excess. She's like, I don't know why this got, why this thing got left out in the final version of the interview. Who paid you to use these political words? Like, it's clear, pretty obvious what your study found.
If you know someone on SSRIs, and I'm sure you do, you might have heard them say something along the lines of, I think I feel a little better, everything is just so bland. They feel numb, like life around them is just happening and they have no real interest or drive to do anything, even things they normally enjoy. This is referred to as anhedonia, and is often associated with a lack of dopamine, the neurotransmitter that promotes motivation and reward. Dopamine and serotonin have well-known opposing effects on each other. Knowing all this, it's reasonable to believe that serotonin is responsible for anhedonia. In fact, one study using an animal model found that there is a direct relationship between the amount of the enzyme that produces serotonin and anhedonic symptoms. Another classical depressive symptom is rumination, constantly dwelling on past events and not looking at the future. Reanalyzing old events intensely is thought to be quite an energy-demanding process, and that the brain may actually be reallocating energetic funds away from other processes, like creating new neurons. This goes hand in hand with anhedonia, as doing pleasurable things typically require more energy that is being devoted to rumination, so it is discouraged. Serotonin, being a compound that reduces energy efficiency, also promotes many processes that are involved in rumination, and acute SSRI treatment exacerbates these symptoms. These mental effects on serotonin really demonstrate why LSD might have significant value when it comes to mental health. LSD is thought to inhibit the synthesis of serotonin and the firing of these serotonergic neurons, as well as potentially promoting dopamine. Of course, there are a lot of things that are pro-dopamine and anti-serotonin and don't make you trip balls, and there's still a lot that we don't know about how the drug works. Still, it illustrates the point. For example, one study showed that LSD has profound anti-rumination effects. It makes people think about themselves in the current moment and about the opportunities to come in their lives. Due to this, research on LSD in helping psychiatric disorders has looked promising, with it showing effectiveness in both anxiety and depression trials. A similar condition, coined learned helplessness, is a term used in the literature to describe a depressed animal model, characterized by inescapable stress, the feeling that there is no way out. In mice, this is basically them giving up on keeping their head above water and allowing themselves to drown. In humans, it's reasonable to believe that this is a driver of suicide, believing the only way out of the stress is to end life altogether. Serotonin has been recognized as an important player in the pathogenesis of learned helplessness. In fact, it causes learned helplessness. This could be a reason why those on SSRIs actually have a higher incidence of suicide. Learned helplessness and serotonin also seem to be involved in drug addiction, as addicts scored higher on the learned helplessness questionnaires, and serotonin receptor blockers decrease impulsivity and make animals significantly less likely to self-administer cocaine. To really illustrate why this is all relevant in today's society are the Rat Park studies. The researchers, interested in addiction, hypothesized that the living conditions that lab rodents typically live in may drive them to use the drugs. These areas are dark, crowded, and don't have a lot of room for fun. The researchers constructed a different habitat for the rats to live. This one much more elaborate, with open spaces, toys, basically rat heaven. They got to run around, mate, and do whatever the hell they wanted to without being restricted to the typical cages. The rats from Rat Utopia consumed far less morphine than the caged up ones, with the males consuming about 16 times less. Even with the horrible withdrawal symptoms that come with morphine addiction, they still didn't go back. So, knowing all this, the picture starts to become clear. The rats in the typical cages probably had some level of learned helplessness, which we know is caused by excess serotonin and plays a role in addiction. On the other hand, the rats with freedom probably did not. By the way, the strongest data on LSD is in its treatment for alcoholism. Is it any wonder why we are where we are in terms of mental health? More people are depressed, addicted, and willing to give up than ever before. People are locked into jobs they don't like, with bosses they don't like, with little agency in either moving up or to an occupation they enjoy.
Coming to bed, honey?
Yes, dear.
Many are in relationships with people they don't even like, but have to be with because of children. Especially recently, People are forced to stay inside all day in front of a screen, doing whatever the job demands of them as they perceive their work as having little to no real impact. Whether it's your boss, your spouse, your TV screen, we're constantly being told what to do and being told how to think. In social situations, you can't say or do what you really want for fear of being ostracized or labeled as weird. Our inner creativity, our true passions, and our identities are being stripped away. How many of us feel like there is no way out of the lives that we live and wish that we could live a freer, more fulfilling one? How different are we than rats in cages? So stay true to yourself. Live your life the way you want to live it. It might just save your life. With all that being said, it cannot be denied that some people do have improvement on SSRIs. Ironically, this could be because over long periods of use, the drugs begin to have a serotonin suppressing effect. Due to the ability of the drugs to increase extracellular serotonin acutely, the body will compensate by synthesizing less. One study showed that chronic administration of the SSRI citalopram resulted in lower levels of serotonin in every brain region studied. Since people rarely benefit from SSRIs without a delay period, it's likely that the benefit comes from this rebound effect. Yes, a drug that only works when it does the opposite of what it's supposed to do. Are you even surprised at this point? Another way by which SSRIs may provide benefit in certain cases actually has nothing to do with serotonin itself, but still opposes its actions. Treatment with SSRIs is known to increase brain concentrations of a steroid known as allopregnanolone. Allopregnanolone is pumped out in great quantities before birth and in early age, declining over time. This is because it is critical for the creation of new neurons and promotes efficient mitochondrial energy production. Those are pretty much the exact opposite of what serotonin does, conserves energy for survival and little else. It seems like this may be the primary reason some improve on SSRIs, as levels of allopregnanolone correlate with symptom severity. In animals, blocking the receptor for allopregnanolone reverses all improvement from SSRIs, even though the increase in serotonin remained the same. In 2019, the FDA approved allopregnanolone as an official treatment for postpartum depression. It's time for a more functional, realistic view of psychiatric disorders. It's so easy to sell the idea that one chemical is all you need to unlock something greater in your life, but that's just not how the world works. Considering different antidepressants can be pro-serotonin, have no effect, or even be anti-serotonin, clearly there's more to the picture. It's unfortunate that serotonin has such an untouchable name in the mainstream, since it seems like in today's world, the last thing people need is more of it. Most of all, the story of serotonin should unequivocally demonstrate that the collective consciousness of hormones, foods, and drugs is entirely determined by the powers that be, and that they never have your best interests.
So you cannot quit these cold turkey. You have to go to your doctor and say, hey, I know that I've been mindlessly asking for these for the last few years, and you've been mindlessly prescribing them to me for the last few years, but I'm really afraid that these are affecting my judgment and clouding my thinking, and I want you to help me wean these down and get off these.
Don't let them fool you. Subscribe to our channel.